Hello there, friendos. It's your old pal, Chad Dukes, and this is my producer, Gigantor. If you're liking what you're seeing here on the Chad Dukes Show YouTube channel, well, we sure would love it if you click like on this video, then maybe hit subscribe. Hit that little bell thing. Isn't that what you do? You hit the bell, and then we spam your phone. We sure would appreciate it. And if you don't want to do that, well, then don't. Those seem to be the options. Take care. Many thanks to the big damn band for this fantastical introduction. And it is the Chad Dukes Show. I am your hostess with the mostest, Big Shoed, screaming into the internet like everybody else is, doing a podcast. Of course, this is the Friday episode, which you're listening to gratis. Thank you to all of you that are listening to it gratis. Hold on, make some time for Breezy. What show? Who? Thank you, Breezy Payton. Appreciate you. Appreciate all of you for checking out the show. If you are sitting here listening to it for free, consider leaving a 5-star review wherever you listen to podcasts, be it Spotify, Google Play, iTunes. I don't know. Wherever you guys get your podcasts. I feel like that's not where anyone gets their podcasts anymore. It's from the traditional walks of life. But we do a daily show on ChadDukeshow.com. You can subscribe. Yes, it costs a couple of bucks, but I got to say, it's the best show I've ever done. And I really think it's way more bang for your buck than most premium subscriptions I've ever dealt with. But that's up to you. We invite you to do that, but we also invite you to continue listening here, and we'll be giving you episodes every week. I, of course, am joined by my executive producer, Gigantor, his Christian name. Tor, looks like it was a bit of a late night for you last night. Were you out having the sex? Were you out eating the fat sandwiches, drinking the seltzers, doing everything that you're known for these days?
All of that would have been a little more favorable, but just driving home from DC at 2:30 in the morning is not
ideal. Yeah, that is not ideal. Tor is here, and I mentioned the fat sandwich. For those of you that just listened to the free episode, you are unaware of what the fat sandwiches are. Unfortunately, you're going to learn real quick, because it's going to be the first segment we give to you from this week's shows. And without spoiling too much, Tor, have you, because the last time I asked you, the answer was no. Have you fully recovered from the fat sandwiches?
It's physically, I think I'm starting to finally get back into my rhythm. Been getting a good amount of cardio in this week. Been, you know, really emphasizing that, as you will learn in this segment, why I need to.
Yeah.
Mentally, I don't know if it's ever going to be anything I can walk back. It's just such a low point.
I got to say, it's something that's haunting. It's probably going to be. I mean, you'll never be able to look at brisket the same way ever again. And when you go out to Winchester, see that poor girl, when she spreads her legs, you're going to look down there and be like, oh my God, fat sandwiches. That poor girl. What did they give a big verbal nod to Monk's Barbecue, of course, founder of the feast, Percival, Virginia. That is some meat that you could absolutely embrace. Don't make yourself fat sandwiches. Go out to Monk's Barbecue. They know how to use fat in the appropriate ways. They don't shovel it down their cake horns because they're blitzkrieg drunk at 2 o'clock in the morning after hammering Bush Lights and watching the original Terminator. Again, spoiler alert. So we're going to give you a bunch of fun stuff today. You will get the origin story of Tor's fat sandwiches. Sean Salisbury was on this week. Anytime Sal's is on the show, he's going to make the Friday episode, because the guy just gives incredible radio every time he comes on. This is no exception. We did a bonus show this week for subscribers. It was an NFL offseason spectacular. Tor didn't think it was that spectacular, but I did. And it was just a bonus show to say thank you to people that subscribed to this program. So those are some of the spiffs you get when you subscribe to the Chad Dukes Show. Speaking of another spiff, you will get the dollar menu segment from the BMI. And you say, well, Dukes, what's that? Well, the Body Mass Index is a segment we do with our buddy Ant-Man each and every week about fast food, about gas station food, about freezer aisle food. What I've learned over the years, working in many different formats in radio, is that the one constant that everybody likes to talk about is grub. It's food. We all eat. And even people that are dieting and watching what they eat, they have some sort of perverse satisfaction in talking about disgusting, awful food. And Ant-Man eats that disgusting, awful food, so you don't have to. And then we go through all the big food stories of the week, and we all participate. And there was some Buc-ee's news, there was some Taco Bell news, there was a whole bunch of stuff. So we're going to get that for you too. But the big update, and I want Tor to give this update because it's very important that you guys know. MyBookie, of course, is a tremendous sponsor of this show, MyBookie.ag. You can use the promo code Dukes anytime you like over there, D-U-K-E-S, and they will match 50% of your initial deposit. That's free money for you. Bet, win, and get paid at MyBookie. Tor, we've only made, I think, three or four official bets on this show with, I think, four total picks. I have given four picks, and you have given four picks for our listeners to go out and gamble on. What is the updated total board for the program?
Dukes is 4-for-4. He is 100% correct on his picks that he's made on the show.
Thank you very much. And what is Tor?
Tor is 0-for-4.
And I feel bad because you picked Curtis Blades, who was an overwhelming favorite. I think plus 345 or something sitting on that bet. I took Derek Lewis simply because he throws bombs and I was going to root for him anyway. And then he starched a dude that was supposed to get a title fight after this one with an uppercut and left him wriggling on the ground, and then hit him with a two-piece combo on the ground afterwards. Everybody's mad at Herb Dean. I just was watching that. I said, God, Tor can't, he cannot catch a break. I was looking at some of these hoops over-unders, Tor, because people betting basketball, even if you're not a, I know people that like have love-hate relationships with the NBA. It's a lot of fun to bet basketball, and it makes you way more interested. Like, I'll go sit at Glory Days and I'll see a game and I'll be like, oh, there's a game I don't care about. Let me just go over to my bookie. Now I care about it. It's that easy. The one that jumped off the table is at me is tonight, as people are listening to this, at 10 o'clock, the over-under of the Charlotte Golden State game is 233 and a hook-a-hook-a-ho. I hate betting the under, but that's my pick for this week. If you're listening to this show on Friday, that's my bet. Take the under in that game. I mean, every time I look at NBA lines, Tor, they get more and more cartoonish. I know I sound like an old man screaming, nobody plays defense, stop launching all these three-pointers, but it happens every single time. I got to think they're going to score less than 233, almost 34 points. That is my pick for this week.
It's an astute pick, and now it makes me wish it was my pick, because unless LaMelo Ball goes off for 40, it's definitely going to hit, because Charlotte doesn't have consistent scoring like that, and Steph's not going to... Steph might go for 50.
He might. Still,
who else is the? Oh my gosh. Okay, that's a better pick. Okay.
What? Are you second guessing yourself already?
Now, yes.
what's the pick? Look, the statistically, you got to guess right at some point here. You can't continue. You know about sports. You bet on sports on a daily basis. You can't continue to be on the schneid. What do you got? Give me one pick.
Okay, so outside of the show, I'm on a heater. Of all heaters.
I'll have to take your word for that, big man.
On the show, it's, you know, we're searching out Arctic creatures down there and getting our capsule infected by the thing. It's so cold.
You're saying it's ice cold down there.
Yes.
You're Andre 3000.
I'm taking the Pacers plus 3 against Boston tonight.
Okay.
I like the Pacers. I like what Bogdanovich is doing. And I've never felt confident in Boston once this season. I'm taking them plus 3
Friday night.
Yes, Friday night tonight.
Okay. Hours from now, if people are listening to this on Friday. Very good. All right, we'll reconvene here and we'll compare picks again in the near future and we'll have a big larf. My bookie friendos, the best. Absolutely the best. College basketball, hockey, the NBA, all taking place. You got baseball firing up soon. So many ways for you to get engaged. Take advantage of MyBookie's prop builder and live in-game betting, where every single run, throw, touchdown, hoop, bucket, whatever, is another chance for you to put cash in your pocket. They got a mobile-friendly website. You can go there right now. I mentioned it. They will match your deposit up to halfway, up to $1,000, just for using my promo code Dukes, D-U-K-E-S. Go to mybookie.ag. Load up that account with the promo code Dukes. There's going to be some free money in that for you, and you can upload your cash any way you want, credit card, bank transfer, Bitcoin, all of it. Whether you're at home or on the go or on your laptop or on your phone, it's not too late to get paid. Bet, win, and get paid at mybookie.ag. Thanks to them for being a wonderful supporter of the Chad Dukes show. Very good. Very good indeed. All right. Tonight on the program, again, if you're listening to this on Friday, and I hope you are, Tor, they got an unbelievable chance to win a PlayStation 5. All you got to do is watch the Chad Duke Show Friday night, Hootenanny, which goes down at 7 p.m. Eastern on Facebook.com/Chad Dukes Show. And you see him, I wasn't bullshitting, Tor. It's sitting in that chair right there. It's sitting right in front of you. Somebody's going to take that bad boy home.
It's oh my God.
It's spectacular, isn't it?
I could just put it under my sweatshirt and walk it out to my car and, I don't know, ride into the sunset with it.
I've had people offer me cash for it already. Like, people have said, look, just pull my name. I'll give you an extra $100. And I'm like, no, I'm not going to do that. But yeah, we'll tell you how exactly you can get your entry to win. All you got to do is watch tonight. We do a free Facebook live stream virtually every Friday. We call it the Friday Night Hootenanny because it is a weird ass show and it continues to get weirder. So tune in on Fridays. If you want to, you can just go to Facebook.com/Chad Duke Show. Click that little bell. I think there's a bell on the profile and it lets you know whenever somebody goes live. All right, Tor, it's time for, look, you're out from the paywall now. Now people, everyone in America is going to learn about your fat sandwiches. I hope you're ready, willing, and able to accept this type of exposure.
It's, you know what? It's better than the meltdown. Barely, though.
Does Mamo know yet?
I can't even. It's tough for me to just even talk to her after after holding this shame of what happened earlier in the
also
week.
Also, because the hard on you always have.
Okay. <That's>...
Don't look at it, Mom. I'm so sorry, Dad. Oh no!
So I'm just walking in my living room with a boner,
just a giant rager. Back to back weeks, by the way, you almost killed Ant-Man and then you ate two fat sandwiches. I mean, you want to talk about a heater. You might not be on one for gambling, but you're certainly on one for your life falling apart. God bless, young man. All right, very good. Pull up a table. Pull up a chair. Tuck that napkin into your collar because it's fat sandwich time on the Chad Duke Show.
The Chad Duke Show merchandise store is up and running. So click the shop tab on ChadDukeShow.com for show t-shirts and koozies.
I am operating under a complete state of delusion as far as how far I've let myself go. So, I don't know if this works for you, Tori. You're not as far gone as I am. But whenever I have one of these moments, I'm like, that's it. I'm getting it together. I'm going to pull my life together. I'm going to start exercising tomorrow. I'm throwing out all this junk food. It's going to be chicken breasts and salads and turkey bacon and all this other bullshit, broccoli. Like, you have these come to Jesus about once a month when you get to wait like this. That fucking night, I don't know why, I decided that it was going to be, I believe it was a weeknight, I think it was Sunday night, that it was going to be a whiskey night. And I'm sitting there and I'm pounding whiskey by myself. My wife goes up to bed. There's nothing more depressing than this. And I realize that DoorDash is closed and that I haven't had enough food in my fat mouth and gut that day. So I go up. I don't know what. I go up into the cupboard, into the pantry, and I see that we have saltines and I see that we have not chili tour. We have hot dog. I don't know what you would call it. Sauce, topping. It's a can of shit you buy to put on top of hot dogs.
Yeah.
Okay? I spread the fucking saltines around in a paper plate, and I dump the entire can of the hot dog sauce all on top of the saltines, then put the shredded cheese on top, stick it in the microwave, melt that, and then I don't even bother to get a fork. I go back down to the television where I'm watching The Departed for the 750 billionth time, and I just sit there shoveling this trash into my mouth. I mean, it's not even, I'm not enjoying it. I don't know that I'm even tasting it. I'm hammered. I've blown out my taste buds with half a pint of fucking whiskey, and I just pummel this concoction, and then I'm so goddamn drunk that I didn't clean it up afterwards so that my wife knew what I did the night before. And of course, she's not trying to bust my balls, but she's shoot concerned. You know, I hope she hasn't Googled lap band surgery details because just a picture of my face just pops up down at the bottom of the goddamn screen at this point. Absolutely revolting. Have I done fatter things in my life? Absolutely. I cannot remember one I am as ashamed of is I am that one in recent history. And the best way to handle that is, of course, to bring it to the show. Fucking revolting. If somebody would have just popped up out of the bushes, held me down like Gulliver, and slapped my belly with a slapjack until it was purple, I absolutely would have deserved it. A little stomach staccato on Duke's fat gut. That was in order on Sunday night.
Now, when you were starting the story about the lap band and the qualifications, I thought it was going to be he offended you because you didn't meet any of them.
No, I met all of them. Okay. Every single qualification. There was a little, you can Google it. There's a little questionnaire that comes up that lets you know, hey, is this, 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 this? And I said, yes, 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 yes. I'm pre-approved, Tor, like an American Express card.
Now, it's funny that you also brought up the come to terms moment because Sunday night was also coincidentally the night that I had my incident. And
really? What was in the air on Sunday night?
That is also the reason I went out and got one of these yesterday.
What is that?
I got myself a...
Is that a Fitbit?
An Apple Watch.
Oh, it's an Apple Watch?
So that's new. So I can really start tracking stuff, yeah.
What happened? I mean, that's a sizable purchase.
So Sunday night, drinking.
Why were we both drinking on Sunday night? It's not smart.
I think we backed that show on Sunday, so we're like, okay.
We're feeling good.
We're ahead of the week. I'm like, all right.
You know what? That probably was what it was, is that we both came into work on Sunday, so we're feeling like hot shit.
Fuck me, dude.
So I'm drinking. I don't even remember what I was drinking. I think I had a vodka and orange juice, just a massive glass of that. And then
that'll do it.
And then I think I might have had, I don't know, 8 Busch Lights that Datsun gave to me.
Oh, you started drinking those?
I got 9 left.
Brother, those are Busch Heavies, by the way. They weren't no fucking Busch Lights. No wonder you were having yourself a rough time. You headed for the mountains.
So already into the night, I'm like, oh, okay. Well, this is a drinking night. It's okay. I'm doing okay. But earlier that day, my mom was slow cooking a whole bunch of corned beef because...
Oh, my God.
It's going to be delicious because she's doing
corned
it right.
Corned beef is great.
They do it right. And I'm like, oh... I'm sitting there watching whatever. I'm like, well, there's some corned beef upstairs, and I'm going to go up there and make myself a couple sandwiches.
I'm going to pummel that shit before anybody else gets a shot at it.
Now, what I didn't know, so there's in the fridge, there were 2 Tupperwares. You know, sometimes there's an extra amount, so you put whatever into the big, however much into the big Tupperware, and then into the little Tupperware, it's like, you know, whatever is left over. So I'm in there. I'm like, okay, this is definitely what happened. And I'm drunk. I'm like, okay, I'll just take the small Tupperware. I don't want to have to deal moving the big Tupperware.
Also, if you have the big Tupperware, there is a chance you'll just pummel everything inside the big Tupperware.
Exactly.
There's always a chance.
So I pick it up. I'm like, okay, here's a couple pieces of fat. I'll just set those over for the dog.
Oh, no. Did you eat a Tupperware full of fat?
I toast up my buns. I get my,
you got to toast up your buns if you're going to suck it from the back, Tor. You know that. Aunt Joe knows that. I can see it in his face.
I get my my pickles. You know, I put the Tupperware into the microwave.
Pickles and corned beef?
Yeah.
Okay.
You know, I pull out my, take the buns out of the toaster, start putting the Tupperware, start putting the corned beef.
Make yourself a nice sandwich. Yeah, sure, yeah. It sounds lovely, actually.
Two of these because it was, drinking.
Two of these because, drinking. That might be the name of the show, I think. Two of these, because, drinking. Actually makes a lot of sense to me. You're saying?
I proceed downstairs and to my cave, and I start eating them. I'm like, oh, this is a little odd. But
it's not the best batch Mamo's ever made, is what you're saying.
Yeah, it was definitely, but I'm, inebriated, so I'm not really caring that much.
Sure.
And then... I eat it and I finish.
Are you playing games? You're watching TV? What are you doing?
I'm just watching SportsCenter or something.
Okay.
And I'm done. I finish. I'm like, okay, cool. All right, that's done with. Go to bed. Next morning, I wake up. Stomach is in knots. I feel absolutely terrible. I go upstairs, and my dad's standing in the kitchen. And I see the Tupperware is still there.
Oh, you were that drunk?
I didn't put it in the sink. It was near the sink, but. And he said, Tor, did.
I like that your dad calls you Tor.
He said, did you eat this entire Tupperware full of fat? From the
What the fuck, dude? Oh, that's fun.
And immediately, I'm like, whoa, 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 whoa. Because I pulled out a couple big chunks that look like golf balls.
Sure.
Obviously for the dog. And then, but some of them, I was looking at the Tupperware. I remember there was some corned beef in there for sure.
You think?
But
doesn't sound like it.
There was, but immediately I got sick to my stomach. I'm like, I just ate two massive sandwiches
of fat.
Of fat. Just dude, pure corned beef fat.
I don't know anyone that's ever eaten two fat sandwiches.
It was depressing.
Right.
It was revolting. I almost threw up in the backyard.
But also, you're drunk.
Yeah.
Like, I mean, that's, at least mine was technically, I knew what I was eating. It's not like I just, I mean, what stopped you from pouring yourself a bowl of dog food? You know, if you're going to go to that, those lengths, I'm surprised you didn't take a shot of dishwashing detergent, something of that. Tide Pods, let me gargle these. You're capable of anything.
I didn't even see myself as like a human that day. Like if I looked in the mirror, it was just some monster looking back at me. Just absolutely disgusting. I don't even know what the cholesterol value is on that. I don't even want to check.
Probably a day's portion, I would assume. Two fat sandwiches. If you were going to be, like, that would be the name of your emo rock group, by the way.
I couldn't stop thinking about the texture either the next day because I knew it was off. It was slimy. It was chewy. It was goopy. I'm like, this is odd. Really, really odd.
You're making me gag a little bit just hearing about it.
Disgusting.
How long did it take you to walk it off?
Walk it off?
Yeah.
I still haven't fully walked it off mentally.
What did your parents say when they realized you ate two fat sandwiches and you did it unintentionally?
They were repulsed.
Because that's the kicker.
My dad said, how drunk were you? I'm like, it's not the drunkest I've been in the last month.
I was drunker down at the beach where I killed that old dude.
So I'm sitting here thinking like, yeah, I wasn't three sheets to the wind, but I was, you know, drunk.
Sunday night, old man. What do you want to do about it? Did you square off with him?
No, but it was like, I also thought I had myself cleared because I picked up one of the things of fat. I started chewing it, and I'm like, oh, okay, this is for sure fat. So I thought I gave myself the green light.
Oh.
So one of the golf balls I put back on the tray, I'm like, oh, I'll give this to the dog afterwards.
So what was the fat being saved for dogs?
Yeah, for the dog. So you could enjoy it with the meals and stuff.
Okay, I didn't know that. I thought that wouldn't make the dog sick.
He's a dog.
All right, fair enough. You should see the food my dog gets. There's more of a food budget for my dog than there is for human beings in my goddamn house. All the treats, everything. The fucking boy, that's really gross. You're not going to be able to probably have that topped.
No, it was very, very disgusting.
Did Mama find out about it?
I hope not.
Oh, so you don't? Would you? Is your dad usually cool about that? Will he keep a secret?
No, not really.
What do you mean, no?
He might have aired me out. My mom's just too polite to bring it up.
Make sure you sign up for the Chad Duke Show mailing list on chaddukeshow.com. Be the first to know what's happening on the program and maybe even win a prize or two. We promise we won't fill up your inbox with tasteful nudes. Well, we promise we'll truly make an effort not to.
It is the Chad Dukes Show, off-season NFL football spectacular. And appreciate you guys tuning in. Thank you to Ken Carmen for coming on the program from Cleveland. And, of course, there ain't no talk of American football around these parts without my guy, Sean Salisbury, the best in the business, host of the Sean Salisbury Show, Sports Talk 790 mornings. You can listen anywhere on the iHeartRadio app. And, of course, he is prolific on Cameo. And the gentleman is a thespian. Every single time, Sal's, I have Showtime on or Stars, I forget how much acting you've done. You always seem to pop up in movies as I'm just browsing through cable.
Yeah, I could use a few more of those because, you know, those residual checks after about 6, 7, 8 years, it starts to say, okay, it's time for another speaking part. So if nothing else, I just got to say, Sandler, just put me in because you feel bad for me so I can keep getting those residual checks, dude. I think with the residual money I got for those three movies, which was really cool, then I start to think, what's the residual money like for somebody like Samuel Jackson who does like 8 movies a year normally, right? Or the residual money for like a Sandler. I'm like, whoa.
Yeah.
I can't fathom what those every 3 months with those checks look like. But I think, okay, now I wonder why. No wonder these actors got into Hollywood when they did it. But yeah, man, I'm going to bug Sandler. I'm ready for another speaking role so those things grow. But some of the funnest times in my life were working on, and not the stuff that you don't see on those movies, some of the outtakes. But yeah, I appreciate it, man. The good times had by all.
You mentioned Sam Jackson, Sal. I know you're a bit of a cinephile like I am. Most people don't know he's in Goodfellas, but he is. I mean, yep. Goodfellas is on cable 750 times a week. Do you think he's getting a little check every single time that's on, in addition to, you know, all the Pulp Fictions and all of the Marvel movies and everything else he's into?
Oh, there's no question. And see, mine's like for instance, Benchwarmers, which was my biggest because I was on speaking part throughout the entire movie, but not as the lead guy who does it. And I think I was looking at those residual checks when it from those three movies, that Benchwarmers, House Bunny, and Longest Yard, in that era when they came out, those 2 or 3 years apart, right? 3 years apart, and they just kept. And I still get them. They're just not near as big, right? And I'm saying I think, okay, what if you're a lead guy? And right, whether it's coming on TV or movies or selling another video or whatever it is, imagine what it looks like, how much you're getting for all the different speaking parts you're doing. It's some of those residual checks, I'm telling you, for the big stars. I know they've been making big money. Residual checks alone would sustain somebody's, I mean, yearly living if you're in those that many movies. I mean, that's just mailbox kiss my rear end money. It's like, oh yeah, man, that's my private plane to Cabo for those guys. So yeah, man, I don't take it for granted. And you know what, Chad, I didn't even realize when we were going, because you pay dues with SAG and AFTRA, right? And then they start sending you like the NFL when you get your like retirement and benefits, and I'm like, gosh dang, when I did that, you know you get a little bit, but I don't. And I start reading my benefits when they send you in like your a quarterly, where your benefits are, I'm thinking, just for this, I get these benefits. When I'm like, I need about 15 more movies with some speaking parts. So like when all is said and done, I can like, oh, okay, yeah, that mail, but every time you go there, because usually it's bills for us, you know,
sure.
But now you go there, it's like, I'll take this. But yeah, when you look at those guys, they're printing money, man. They are printing money when it comes to that. But it's what a blessing. If I never get another one, that's okay. But if I do, then I'll count those blessings too. But that's some of the funnest times I've ever had.
I always stand up and I point and I say, I know that guy. And then my wife leaves the room. That's generally the way that it goes.
There you go.
Speaking of well compensated, so I want to get to, you live in the epicenter of weirdness in sport right now. So I want to get to what's going on in H-Town. But the Art Rooney situation is interesting. So he pens this letter basically saying, I guess we can't pay Big Ben $19 million. First of all, how weird is it, Sal, to get to a point where you're hearing Ben Roethlisberger wants to play for the Steelers, but the Steelers aren't sure they want to pay Ben Roethlisberger when I believe it's Mason Rudolph and Dwayne Haskins they have in the coffers. I got to assume they're going to get that banged out, but I also got to assume they ain't paying him no $19 million a year. His play degraded last year. What do you make of that situation right now?
Yeah, Chad, and here's what's interesting. Really, for a guy of his – you know, the skins, the trophies and plaques he has on the wall and what he's done, right? You'd think $19 million in this day and age, hell, we're going to get receivers. Like Will Fuller's probably going to ask in his, you know, if he contract, he, you know, doesn't play full season. I just use him as an example because he's here in Houston. He's the franchise tag. What's a franchise tag going to pay a receiver? $17-18 million. So you get to a point where really this day and age, $19 million, you think for a guy like that is like, well, you should be able to pay that, right? Although it's a lot of money. You know, when you start to think about Dak's going to get close to, you know, around 40, that's what Watson's making. I know, and Ben's had seasons like that. Yeah, but it did fall off. He became, instead of a push it down the field on a regular occurrence, it was, they played more sideways football than they've ever done, like average yards per completion and attempt and all that. And while Ben still got some game, I don't know if it's Super Bowl game anymore. And I have the utmost respect for him on the field and what he does and what he's done. And this team and this franchise, the continuity, I was thinking, hey, do you realize Chuck Knoll started in 1969 as a head coach? We are now in 2021. They've had three coaches in 52 years. And when you look at the success of the franchise at a lot of different positions, the quarterback, long careers, Bradshaw. I mean, when they've been successful, front office, head coaches with Cowher and Tomlin and the ownership with the Rooneys, there's a continuity that goes, it'll be weird. I think it'll get done, but it's not going to be at that. And we heard Kevin Colbert, the GM, about a week and a half or 2 weeks ago, maybe it was last week, and it was talking about, and it wasn't a ringing endorsement. Basically, you could tell through the way it was talked about that if Ben wants to be the starting quarterback, which he's the best on their roster currently, then he's going to have to take a pay cut. And I would imagine that that's part of what's going on for him to be there. And he's not going to get traded. It's $41 million on a dead cap hit. Nobody's going to pay that. You'd have to cut him if you didn't want him. So I would imagine you're going to see Ben Roethlisberger starting quarterback, Pittsburgh Steelers, one more year in Pittsburgh. at a lesser than $19 million salary if he wants to stay. If not, they'd move in a different direction, and maybe they're going to even be active in the draft or trade anyway to find that next guy, because they got to start looking for it. If they think Haskins is just a guy, or the Mason Rudolph is just a guy, then they got to start looking for that guy, because if Ben plays another year as a starter, I can't see it extending to two or three more years. So it'll be at a lesser price if he's their quarterback.
He's so synonymous with the town, and then you get to athletes that are synonymous with the town, and then I think it goes J.J. Watt, and then probably everybody else not named Aaron Rodgers, maybe. Sal's, what has it been like covering that story and talking? I mean, it's just been so bizarre, and there's so much acrimony and animosity towards the ownership group. But, I mean, you want to talk about transcending a sport and working in a community and charity and all that stuff. I know he had his detractors. Some people thought maybe it was a bit of an act, but I don't see a lot of bad stuff about J.J. Watt anywhere. And I can't imagine an athlete that means too much more to a community than what he did to that one. What has it been like discussing on the radio his exodus?
Yeah, and that's not even withstanding the Watson thing. Just Watt as a standalone, compartmentalized. Yeah. Listen. Like all athletes, if the worst thing we can say about J.J. Watt is that some of his videos and box jumps are, you know, like look at me. That's society now. We say look at me after we've got off the gym and did four sets of curls, and we're taking mirror selfies at the gym. Okay, so I'm okay if J.J. Watt wants to show me he had 40-inch box jumps or whatever it is. If that's him and all the other stuff he does, we can live with it. Okay, his impact on this community. I know a lot of Chad. You and I know this for sure that. We see some of the bad in communities, you know, if somebody, you know, something happens or a guy gets cut or whatever it is, or contract struggles. But the good that most of these athletes do far outweighs the negative that goes on with some of the community. It does, whether it's charity or giving time or whatever it is, making a difference quietly, silently, or out loud, whatever you do. Sometimes you can't make it quietly because other people are talking about it anyway. And a lot of times you bring attention to yourself, but what it does is it makes other people, like when I see somebody like what J.J. Watt does, it makes me want to go into their Mattress Mac, makes me want to go in the community and do more. So if it's self-serving at times for people to say, hey, look what I did or look what we're doing, that's okay because it makes us want to do the same thing. So it's kind of a good thing. So if that's the worst thing J.J. Watt is a guy that people say, oh, he's giving money to charity again or doing something and making a difference. He is. I've been in this town a while. And I played in a lot of towns. I don't remember an impact, an athlete. I'm sure other cities have the same guy. But when I played in Minnesota, we had guys that made an impact. Growing up in San Diego, Tony Gwynn made a huge impact. I mean, Junior Seau was huge at it. I can name guys. I can't name anybody that's done more that's been so dominant on the field and off the field. As good as he is as a person and a dominant player, he's made more of an impact off the field, and that's saying something when you're the three-time defensive player of the year. So while he may not be Myles Garrett now, if you stuck him with Myles Garrett on the same offensive line, he'll get double-digit sacks. The motor runs. He doesn't quit playing. Teammates love him. He is going to work. He's going to put his time in to prove to you you're wrong. So he's overcome surgeries and everything. But I know it's probably a little – to the point where there's so much talk about the front office and JJ being out that it gets a little, it wears people out, but his impact has been so prevalent on this community, whether it's Hurricane Harvey, anything, and other things that we don't know that he does. It's a loss. I'm happy for him that he gets to go somewhere whenever he decides, somewhere that can give him a chance to win, because he wasn't going to win here in the next few years. Even with Watson, if he stays, because this team's got a lot of stuff to do. I can't wait to see him on a team that's got good players on defense. I mean, a lot of them, and a scheme with a chance to win. But you're going to be hard, and he'll go into whatever community, Chad. It doesn't matter whether it's Green Bay or Pittsburgh or Buffalo. He'll make an instant impact off the field. He will go in, and whether it's money or raising money over the next 3 years, people will say, man. And that's what he's been doing, feels like, on a weekly basis here. Phenomenal human being. Great football player, and if the worst we can say is that, oh, look at him again, he's on social Instagram, and he draws attention to stuff that needs drawn attention to, because you almost feel like, gosh, man, I'm a mere mortal compared to this cat, right? So I got nothing but praise for him. he's not the number one on a defense anymore, but I can tell you this, he's still very productive and will have something to prove because he'll want to, but his impact off the field, we get J.J. Watt. You'll have a hangover from losing him, but you'll also, and I know it, with the number of the constant talk, it gets a little bit maddening, but he's earned every bit of it when it comes to the good stuff. And I do nothing but wish him. I'm glad he got out of here, not for the fans' sake, but for a chance to go win, because he wasn't going to win here before he retired.
Tor, I know you got a question for Sal's, but I wanted to follow up with that. Carmen floated on the show before you came on, Sal's, that he thinks that maybe one of the reasons why J.J. Watt's laying in the weeds is he's waiting to see if Deshaun Watson does get traded to Miami or one of these places that we're hearing all the rumors about, and that they get along and it's kind of a package situation. Do you buy into a scenario like that?
Oh, I think there's a little bit of it. I mean, why rush? You know, I sit there and think about he's never had a chance to do this, and he wasn't highly recruited in high school when he came from high school to college. And quite frankly, he got booed a little bit when the Texans drafted him. They didn't like the pick. And then they blinked and realized, ooh, this guy's really good. Why not enjoy it? And I agree with Ken in a sense that why would I want to go somewhere that maybe they're going to go 8-8? I know they offered me, you know, at this stage, if it's $10 million, if it's $9 million, if it's $12 million, I know $3 million makes a difference, but I would think that the order of preference would be winning, possible family, friends, location, depending, and then money, and the guys he's going to be with. But why not? It'd be like if you were thinking about the Yankees and Garrett Cole when he was going to leave here, the Angels and the Yankees, or if you were a guy that was a big bopper and you said, "Man, I want to go." I like that cat. Or if George Springer was a year ahead of time and Springer's leaving, you think, well, maybe I should go there because I know how good he is. It gives me a better chance to win. And they're friends and they respect each other. And I think there's a major mutual respect between the two. Why not? You heard DeAndre Hopkins say, come here and finish what we started in Houston to Arizona. JJ is going to have options. And I don't think there should be a rush. Well, listen, enjoy this. This will be the last time in his career he gets courted like this now in his post career, whether it's TV or acting or whatever he does. But this is the last time as a football player he's going to get courted like this, where he's going to have 6-8 teams that say, man, he could be the one defensive guy in Tennessee that gets us to another level or whatever. And if Watson ended up in Carolina, well, maybe. If Watson ended up in Miami or New York, Robert Saleh, what's not to like about that? I can go there. It's New York. I got off-the-field aspirations. It's Madison Avenue. Who knows why, but I don't blame him. What's the rush? Let them take you on a steak dinner in a private plane. Or Zoom call you and tell you how good you are. I don't think there's anything wrong. What's the rush? As long as you don't wait too long and you're like, well, now you're forced into there's only two teams instead of eight. But I would imagine this deal will be done in the next 15 to 30 days. But I also don't know if he's going to wait all the way till Watson. Maybe he'll get speculation from Watson's agent or more insight. But I think that if he knew Watson was going to make the decision in 10 days, or if the Texans, should I say, are going to say, we're trading you, and here's the two or three teams, maybe JJ would make that. I don't think that's going to be the number one reason, but I don't think it would hurt if he went to Pittsburgh and his brothers were there. And you say, well, Watson, my brothers, I think he'd probably take a dollar or two less to go do that. So, yeah, I think that's part of it. But I also think it's going to be a chance to win, because this will be his last chance to get a Super Bowl ring as a significant player as well the next couple of years.
You can always donate to the Chad Dukes Show using the Donate tab on ChadDukesShow.com. You'll help us keep improving the product, and you'll earn yourself a verbal nod on the next episode. We thank you for your support, friendos.
Time for some dollar menu.
This is the Body Mass Index on the Chad Dukes Show.
All right, very good. Now, you said you pulled a few stories, right, Amir?
Yes.
Why don't you go first, then?
Okay, so first, not only is there cotton candy grapes, but now...
What?
There are candy snaps flavored grapes.
Candy snaps?
Yeah.
I've had the cotton candy grapes. I don't know. What is a candy snap?
They are saying that it is...
Maybe you should read the story before
I did. I just forgot how they described it.
Doesn't sound like that. It sounds like you read the headline.
It's a purple candy flavored grape.
That sounds like cotton candy.
Yeah, it does. But they're saying that it's different. So
In what way, Ant-Man? Do you think maybe it's in the article, and if you would have read the article, that you would know?
No, it literally doesn't say what the difference. It just says that we've spotted the purple candy snaps grapes on the shelves.
What?
And it doesn't give anything about the flavor, except they're calling it the purple candy snap grapes.
You got to stop pressing him, because I told him about my story earlier, and I'm afraid that he's going to backslide.
He's going to freak and then just blurt out your story.
He's going to say my story.
Like he did down at the beach.
Good story, him.
Orange drink, McDonald's. Holy shit.
I'll redeem myself.
Tor, have you ever had a grapele?
I have not. I don't know what the hell he's talking about.
Well, no. He mentioned you've had a cotton candy grape?
No.
So they have those. They're cotton candy flavored grapes. They're pretty good. They're supposedly all natural. I don't know how they do it. A grapele or a grapple, I've never figured out how you say it. They take apples and they inject them with grape juice. So when you bite them, like, you get like a burst of grape flavor, and then it's just like eating an apple. They're pretty fucking good. They come in like a plastic 4-pack. They're usually up front in the produce for the grocery stores.
Oh, I'll have to find one. So is it like those sparkling ciders that you sometimes you have when you're a kid at like Christmas and stuff like that? Is that how it tastes?
I don't know. What sparkling? You mean instead of like having champagne?
Yeah.
Maybe a little bit like that.
That's interesting.
It's good. You like them. It's a nice snacking item. I haven't seen them recently, but I know they do have them at the grocery stores. All right, very good. I think it's time for Tor's got a. Uh-oh, hold on.
This is the Body Mass Index on the Chad Dukes Show.
Coming up the stairs there. By sale. Sorry, Tor. Proceed.
My story, Taco Bell.
I like it.
They are currently testing.
Say no more, fam.
A crispy chicken sandwich taco in Nashville right now. The full release is expected on March 11th. Now, it looks like a taco. It almost looks like a pancake wrapping around a crispy chicken strip. So they are now entering, and pardon me for saying this.
Oh, here he comes.
The chicken wars.
I love that the chicken sandwich wars are something that we have to hear about every 10 seconds when every fast food establishment has had a fried chicken sandwich for as long as I've been alive. Unbelievable.
I have not ever really been that high on Taco Bell's chicken products because their other products just blow everything else out of the water.
Right.
So, I mean, I'll be inclined to try it because a soldier in the chicken wars.
You're a soldier in the chicken wars. You've always said that.
Wow.
I'm kind of in the trenches here.
Sure.
I gotta, see what it's all about.
Well, a couple of things. One is, if you Google it, chicken sales as a whole are skyrocketing. Beef sales are, I wouldn't say plummeting, but they're not as high and robust as they used to be, because what they've done is they've done a very good job of convincing the American public that if you eat chicken, it's good for you. When it's deep fried, of course, it is not. And I would say it's comparable to a lot of the burgers you'll have. Taco Bell's biggest gaffe in their history, in my opinion, is the chicken taco shell. It could have been their greatest triumph. It ended up being their worst. They decided, for whatever reason, to make the chicken shell out of chicken and then fill it with just lettuce and tomatoes and some sort of green goop, because everyone loves putting goop on everything. They didn't put any meat in the goddamn taco. And what they didn't understand is you're just replacing the shell. Like when KFC did the double down, they had bacon and cheese and shit in between the fried chicken. They didn't just put lettuce and tomatoes and mayonnaise. They realized they were replacing the bread with pieces of fried chicken. Taco Bell fucked that up. I don't think they've ever walked it off. And I'm with Tor. Any type of adventurous thing they do like this generally gets a lot of buzz. I don't like it. Like, I just wish they would bring back the volcano sauce, first of all. You should be able to put volcano sauce on anything at Taco Bell. Your Doritos Locos Tacos needs to go back into the engineering, it needs to go back in the lab, because it just falls apart the second you bite into it. They got a lot of strengths, man. Like, Taco Bell, as far as drunk food, it's probably a one seed for anybody. I just think there's things they can do that are better going to serve their time than something like this.
They've almost got a strength. They still have a stranglehold, I'd say, in the 3 seed or maybe the 2 seed in the drink category.
You think so?
The Baja Blast and the Freezes. They're still really,
well, nobody
really
does
popular.
Exclusive sodas like Taco Bell does. Nobody.
Right. There's still high schoolers that are just dedicated to that Taco Bell Baja Blast lifestyle. It's, all right, we're going to go to the football game, we're going to go to Taco Bell, and then we're going to go...
I didn't realize, I got to hear more about this lifestyle, man.
Yeah, I had no clue, and I've been a lot involved in a lot of lifestyles.
And a lot of Taco Bells.
Yeah, I go there almost every day for the nacho fries.
You've been a part of both of those things.
Yeah.
Another thing Taco Bell, if we're talking Taco Bell, they have been able to keep their reputation of, man, I'm just going to go order 15 different things and like it's so cheap at Taco Bell, it's so cheap. It ain't.
It's not.
It's the most expensive fast food place I go because I generally get a couple of burritos and a couple tacos and a drink and then it's $17. I don't know how it happens. I don't know how I can go to Arby's and they got like two beef and cheddars for $5. You get a curly fry, you're out of there for $8. Like, how is Arby's at this point cheaper than Taco Bell? I don't get how they still have that reputation.
It is crazy. And like, even with their fries, so like, I love the nacho fries, but they only have the one size and it's small. So you have to, if you really want to have an amount of a decent amount of nacho fries, you have to order like three of them, and it's not discounted.
Of course you do.
It's like $2 and change a piece, and then you feel like such a fatty getting three that you got to order enough tacos to make it look like there's three people eating them. So every time I walk out of there, I'm walking out with six tacos and three nacho fries.
The rationalization is so hilarious.
You've got the ultimate strategy here.
Dude, but those you're right about, and the holster is like it's like a squared circle, and the fries are kind of fat.
Yeah, they
so you are. Get like nine fries.
Yeah.
Although I do love that commercial. You don't consume me, I consume you. Yeah. That's a great commercial for those nacho fries. They're good though.
I love them.
Is it still up in the air? Why isn't that just a menu item? Like, why is that a limited time deal?
I'm not sure. I know it's available now because I've been getting them a lot, but. I think I've had them probably 4 days this week so far.
Say, man, what's the schedule? Because you told us you go to McDonald's every day for breakfast.
Yep.
So then it's the nacho fries for lunch every day?
I get the nacho fries probably 3 days a week. Okay. As long as I pass by a Taco Bell, I'm stopping to get nacho fries. And the good thing is the office has one right across the street. So
you're always – it's not if you pass, it's not if you pass by. It's when you pass by
correct.
A Taco Bell. Okay. I do have that policy with Chick-fil-A. Like, I don't know what – I can drive past a McDonald's. I can drive past a Burger King. If I see a Chick-fil-A, I'm at least stopping to get a large Coke Zero and some tenders. And probably some waffle fries. And probably mac and cheese. Like, at least getting that. Even if it's not necessarily mealtime. That's the one place where I'm like, it's there. I gotta go. Because I think that... Am I incorrect, boys? I know there's a lot of Chick-fil-A's, but I feel like there's way less Chick-fil-A's than there are, like, Chipotle's and Subway's and all this other shit we see everywhere.
Chick-fil-A almost does, like, the when you're developing a streetwear brand, you don't want to flood the market immediately.
True.
So people want your stuff.
Ant-Man knows about that.
Yep.
You don't want to step on it too hard, too much baby laxative. It will knock off retreat customers.
So you're going to get more demand and want when you're only releasing 200 jackets opposed to 2,000. You see the sold out. You're like, oh, next time this drops, I got to get it.
Sure.
Chick-fil-A, it's almost the same instance. You're like, oh, there's Chick-fil-A. I got to get it now. There's not one 2 feet away from my house. I just stumbled across one. I'm going to go get some.
It is one of those places, though, that I firmly believe, because Lewis Black had the joke about Starbucks many years ago. If you built a Chick-fil-A across the street from a Chick-fil-A, I think they both would do well. Because I've just never driven past one where there isn't a line. And there's not a line for the same reason there is in Popeyes. I love Popeyes, but it's because the people that work there hate your guts and they don't want to serve you. At Chick-fil-A, they're cranking the whole time and there's still a goddamn line.
And most of them have the two lines now, and they
yeah
they
I don't
manage
get that.
To
how's that faster, by the way, because you have to combine down to one line in the drive-through.
I think it's just so the line's not wrapping around the building four times.
I gotta say, this is, you guys are gonna lose a little respect for me, the Chick-fil-A in Fairlakes during Christmas brings me joy because they deck it out with lights. They put lights all over the parking lot and they have an army of employees out and they're all wearing red and like hats and stuff. And they're like, hello, sir. Merry Christmas. Would you like a peppermint patty shake? I'm like, the fuck? Yes, I would. And they hand me a Bible. And I'm like, thank you. I'm going to study this as I'm waiting in line. I fucking love, I like, even when I'm driving, you know the one I'm talking about, man. When you drive past it, it's all lit up and mm-hmm. I see the big line, everybody's smiling. I'm like, I just like knowing it's there. They could knock down that fucking Taco Bell in that same parking lot, put another Chick-fil-A and it would crush just as well.
Yeah. And that's the other thing about Chick-fil-A is that the customer service people are always so polite.
Best.
I mean, you're never going to get screamed at or told to just like that they didn't mess up your order, that you're wrong, sir, or you know, they just, it's always correct. They always are polite. It's such a great experience.
And they ask for your name, and at first, like, I was always kind of put off by that, but then I realized, oh, I'm talking to talk to four more people before I get my food, and they're like, Chad, how are you? Is this your order? Is there anything else you'd like? Crash your credit, sir. How about you just keep it for free? Yeah. Like, they're so nice as you're going around the bend. And then it's never, do you want sauce? It's what sauces would you like?
Yeah.
And I'm like, I want 12 of the buffalo. And they don't ever ask. They throw it right in the goddamn sack, and then I drive off.
Yep.
It's the only fast food place I've actually gone on Yelp and left a positive review. I got to tell these people how great they are. All right. I believe it's my turn for the dollar menu.
This is the Body Mass Index on the Chad Dukes Show.
I love the production. Tor, are you familiar with what Buc-ee's is?
It's a gas station, I believe. It's of the Wawa type. Am I?
Well, I think that's not giving it the credit it's deserved. Buc-ee's, I believe, originally there were three in Texas, in or around Houston, San Antonio, Dallas. I'm not exactly sure. I just know there were three in Texas. It's Wawa. If Wawa did HGH for 300 years, it's fucking enormous. It's the size of a Walmart, and they have 120 gas pumps. It's very Texas-y. And they make all their own shit, Tor. So they have their own jerky, their own candy, their own snacks. They've got loads of paraphernalia. They got soda aisles. I mean, go online, everybody, and Google Buc-ee's walkthrough. And the guy's a little creepy because he walks into the bathroom, and I don't think he got anybody's, tacit approval. But the enormity of these places, and I've never been. I've never been because I've been to Texas three or four times and I just never went. But I've been a fan for years. And listeners have been nice enough to send me Buc-ee's care packages. Our buddy Dave Testa, whenever Buc-ee's puts out their Thanksgiving shirt or their 4th of July shirt, he gets me a double XL. It doesn't fit me. I cry for a day or two. It's just a tremendous, tremendous place. I love gas stations. I think we all love convenience stores, right? And it's the biggest. It's the mother load. It's the Incredible Hulk of convenience stores. So Buc-ee's opened up their travel center, is what they called it. In they've expanded to Florida, and they've expanded to Georgia.
Oh, wow.
So they're moving, and I believe they were already in Alabama. This just happened by the way, Florida does not give a fuck. They just had this Buc-ee's grand opening down, I think it was St. Augustine, and it was, there's a billion people there. There's just, they're airdropping people, and they love Buc-ee's. Buc-ee's is breaking ground in South Carolina.
Oh, my God.
Now look, I ain't going to drive to South Carolina just to go to Buc-ee's.
I might.
I will drive to North Carolina just to go to Buc-ee's. And the fact that they are creeping ever closer to us is absolutely tremendous. Now, I've seen some bitching from Texas people, because Texas people are hot about two things. One, Whataburger is expanding. They got bought by this big banking firm in Chicago, I think, and they're opening up a Whataburger in Nashville. Now, Nashville can go fuck itself. I'm going to tell you why. Tor just said that Taco Bell is testing their chicken sandwich in Nashville. Nashville is getting a Whataburger. Nashville doesn't need shit, Tor. We good? We good? Nashville doesn't need shit. They've got the best food. They got all the concerts. They got the hot women. They got the booze. They got records. They got the Sixth Avenue. They got everything you possibly need. It's an awesome town. You know who needs a Whataburger and a Buc-ee's? Manassas. That's who needs it. Winchester, Fredericksburg. These places where everybody that lives there wants to die, and they should, because they're awful. We need that stuff around here. Our lives stink. South Carolina, you know, good people have it in South Carolina. Weather's beautiful. They got Myrtle Beach. They got Columbia. They got that beautiful flag with the palm tree and the moon. We got a naked dude with bitch tits standing with a spear. Don't even ask Maryland. Maryland looks like they have diarrhea all over their flag. They put it on the back of every car in the goddamn. We got to get it. We got to get some of the stuff in our neck of the woods, boys. I don't want Buc-ee's to ever come to Virginia, because Virginia will ruin Buc-ee's.
Yeah.
We ruin everything. But I want them to go to North Carolina. And I want them to go so we can hit it on the way going down to the Outer Banks or something like that. That is the goal.
That would be amazing. The Bucky's care packages that you get, they're Bucky's nuts and all that.
Bucky's nuts.
I think that's what they're called.
Nuggets, I believe.
Bucky's nuggets and the orange creamsicle gummies and, dude, oh my God, they have such good
snacks. The jerky's
snacks.
Good. Those, I don't know what those like dusted almonds are.
Yeah, those
oh
were
my
amazing.
God. And there's two crazy motherfuckers that always send me Bucky's care packages. And by the way, guys, if you're listening, and I do for the re-up. Ant-Man's been there tour when I'll be sitting, like, we'll be out back or whatever in the pool, and I'll just bust open the box, and it's filled to the brim with, like, $300 worth of Bucky's. And I'm just like, everybody dig in. It's a good day
it's
for
so
everybody.
Good, yeah.
The jerky's good, too, man. It's tough, yeah. It's tough to do jerky.
Even that hot jerky that they sent up was really good.
And you don't like hot jerky.
No.
What do they call Ant-Man? They call him the, what do we say his new name was? The big confetti, or what was it, the cake confetti?
There was something last night that we deemed him.
No. What was that thing that you just said you were eating and you got the different flavor?
Funfetti.
Funfetti. We call Ant-Man Big Funfetti when he's walking around here. That's his rap name. Big Funfetti. You got another one, Ant-Man?
I do. Actually.
Hold on. Wait for your production.
Body Mass Index on the Chad Dukes Show.
You got to wait for your production, Ant-Man, for God's sakes.
Sorry. I actually have two. I'll blow through them pretty quickly here. You know the goat's candy, the caramel with the cream in the middle of it?
It's
called Goetz, G-O-E-T-Z-E-S.
I have not heard of it.
So it's like a caramel wrapped around a cream. They actually have an Oreo.
Huh?
The bullseyes.
I think I know what you're describing. I've never heard it called a Goetz or a bullseye.
Well, that's just the brand.
I've only seen them in like the plastic, the clear wrapping.
Yeah, that's what I'm
talking
about.
Seen a name on it. You know?
Okay. So they actually have a new flavor that is caramel creams with Oreo. It's got chunks of Oreo in the creamy center. It's still the caramel around the outside, and then they have, I believe it says here that there's a chocolate flavored exterior as well.
You're a caramel pronunciation guy? That's surprising.
Caramel.
You would seem like a caramel guy to me.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of things have changed in the past week.
Right, there's some brain function. We'll address that on the hoot. Yeah. Some stuff we need to get to.
And so those are in stores now. And then also, Lay's for a limited time, so they may not be new, I don't know, fried pickles with ranch-flavored chips.
Lay's has done so much with the pickle chips. I don't know if they're new. I know they won't be good. God bless Lay's for trying. All of their chips taste like barbecue potato chips or ranch potato chips. It's all, and they're too thin. I always get fooled into it though, man. Like if I see like, oh my God, Kansas City barbecue Lay's, or oh look, this is baby back ribs Lay's, I always will buy a bag, and then I'm always disappointed every single time. So I love Hers, man. Hers, you ever had Hers chips,
Hers
here, man?
Are really good, yes.
Best, and all pale in comparison, of course, to Texas Trey's.
Yes,
of course,
King Texas, dictator Texas Trey.
Well, he might be usurped tomorrow evening. Mm-hmm. Very excited by Ant-Man.
Yeah, that's not going to happen. I'm still poor. But they are available at Sam's Club now, and that's the Lay's Fried Pickles with Ranch.
Remember to follow the show on social media, at Chad Dukes on Twitter, and Chad Dukes Show on Facebook, Instagram, YouTube, and Twitch.
Thank you to Ant-Man. Thank you to Sean Salisbury. Of course, thank you to Tor's Enormous Sense of Guilt. All of it provided a very entertaining free episode of the Chad Dukes Show. Hope you guys enjoyed it. Hope you're considering subscribing over at ChadDukesShow.com. We do a show every single day. There's bonus episodes all of the time. It really is a fun community. We got a nice little group of listeners, and it's been a gas, man. It's the show I've always wanted to do. So consider checking it out. ChadDukesShow.com. You can subscribe right there. Tonight is the Hootenanny. You can watch that gratis. It's a fun show. Just go to our Facebook page, and it will be there and ready, willing, and able for you. I will be working at Commonwealth Dry Goods on Saturday. So if you'd like to roll on by and say hi to your pal, Big Shooter, pick yourself up a little jerky, pick yourself up an ice-cold Cheerwine, well, that would be fine, too. We're in Old Town of Fairfax. Tor, thank you for you. Thank you to you, buddy. It's been a really solid week of shows this week.
Of course, and I'm very excited for tonight's Hootenanny.
It'll be a weird one.
It'll be fun. I don't know what I'm going to do or say when I see Dick Smokehand sitting across from me.
I don't know either.
It's going to be really odd.
It's going to be strange. He's got the holes in his feet. He's got the fake COVID. He's got the big head. So that's going to be strange. Yeah, we've got a lot to get to tonight, including giving away a PlayStation 5. So hopefully we see you guys at 7 o'clock Eastern Standard Time. Excellent. Have a beautiful weekend, everybody. If you want to hang out this weekend, I will be on Chad Dukes Show Gaming on Facebook. I'm going to jump on there and stream at least once. So it's another way for us to hang out. If the good Lord is willing and the creeks don't rise, we'll meet you back here on Monday at 2 p.m. or roll out the trash cans.